us on this wonderful summer Sunday evening. How about page number 22 in your songbooks, please? And let's stand together. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Page number 22. Lift it up as we sing the verse together now. Blessed assurance.
Sets the temperature for the church. It's just an indication of what's going to come tonight. We're going to be in for a special treat this evening. Thank you for joining us, and we're looking forward to the Lord doing some great things. It's been wonderful to be in Sunday school, Sunday morning, the teacher's meeting, and now Sunday night. And we thank the Lord for God's people and your faithfulness. Let's commit this service to our Savior as we go to the Lord in prayer. Father, what a tremendous message this morning from our pastor, Deuteronomy 30, this day. And God, we thank you for what you've accomplished in our hearts this day. And Lord, we're asking you to move again tonight in power. And Lord, I pray that your word would have free course in every heart and life. May you give great liberty as the word of God is declared boldly. And I pray, Lord, that you would work and perform spiritual surgery in our hearts and lives. And God, I pray we leave here more like the Lord Jesus. We thank you for your love and goodness to us. We thank you for just the way that you care so tenderly for us. We ask all these things in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you for standing.
A man possessed by devils, his body vexed with pain. Could not be bound by chains. Yet at the name of Jesus, the devils fled away. The people were amazed to
438 in your songbooks, please. I Want That Mountain. We appreciate the special and the choir. Here's a good song that we get to sing tonight, 438. On the first, lift it up together now.
I saw the giant of prayerlessness upon the mountain high. He laughed so hard and my heavenly. With no longer in the wilderness of sin, so I cry. I want the mountain in the I'll sing right now. I want that mountain. I want that mountain. Where is the mountain? Where the prince of the snow? I want that mountain. Oh, I want that mountain. The mountain that my heart made died on a tree for me, and I'm gonna live forever.
I know my name may never be hung in lights upon a marquee, because Jesus Christ died on a tree, I'm gonna live forever. King of the Jews, the cross proclaimed, while those around him mocked his name. It was for me that he bore all the shame, so I could live forever. I'm gonna live forever. I'm gonna die, no, never. Jesus died on a tree for me, and I'm gonna live forever.
No, my name will never be written down in history, but Jesus wrote my name in the book of life, and that's enough for me.
Someday he's coming back again.
Jesus died on a tree for me, and I'm gonna live forever.
It took a lot of power to part the Red Sea, and it took a lot of power to do a lot of the miracles in the Bible, but it took a lot of power to save you. It took a lot of power to save me, and that was a miracle to take your old dead spirit and depraved heart and God to quicken it and make it like Him. What in the world? Can you imagine that? He came to where we were, reached down by His grace, and picked us up out of the ditch, and not perfect, but redeemed, and a new creature in Christ. That's a miracle right there. People say, well, God doesn't do miracles like He used to. You're looking at a room full of them right here. Amen. Ushers, if you'll come quickly, please, we want to go over the bulletin tonight. There's a lot of announcements in this bulletin, front and back, and so you'll want to read this throughout the week if we don't cover it all. But if you need a bulletin, would you raise your hand, please? Let the ushers see that, and they'll make sure that you get one. It's good to be back in church on Sunday night, and I'm glad that we don't just do it once a week. I'm glad that we have it again on Sunday night, and then on Wednesday night, too. And we don't need less, that's for sure. And you might get hurt with too much of some things, too much ice cream, something like that, but not church. You'll never go overboard in that area, I promise you. And I'm glad that you're here tonight. Look with me here, if you would, at these announcements quickly. The events of the week on Monday, that's tomorrow night, the ladies' volleyball season begins. And it will start here in the gymnasium at 6:30 p.m. So if you're playing, then you want to make sure that you're here 6:30. Be here a little bit early, but 6:30 p.m. for the first games to begin. And that starts tomorrow night. Wednesday, I just mentioned, we have church again on Wednesday night. And it's 6:30 p.m. And we are well aware that you work throughout the week and then you rush to get here on Wednesday night. And so we don't hold it back. There'll be singing, there'll be preaching, there'll be an offering. It'll be church on Wednesday night. What I'm saying is it is worth your effort to get here. And we're praying that God will speak to us on Wednesday. All the children's ministries for the summer are in operation as well. And you know all about that. Thursday, men's softball will continue, and that begins at 5:15 p.m., and if you've yet to come, there's plenty of seating there. You can bring your own chair as well. There's concessions. The new park out here that has been built is really nice, actually, so if you have young people and they don't want to hold still, you can take a walk back here and look at that, but it'd be worth it for fellowship. Come on at 5:15 on Thursday p.m. Let's look here. Right after the service tonight, there's a two committed couples class activity. If you're in that Sunday school class, you'll get nachos and brownies Sundays in the courtyard, and that happens right after the service. But before that, if you're part of the special music around here, if you play an instrument, if you sing, then there's a brief meeting for you down in the choir practice room. That is number 4 here on the bulletin, and you can read that, number 3, number 4. Number 5, Saturday, is the last Saturday before youth conference, and so there will be a bus washing on Saturday morning, 6:45 to about 8 a.m. Usually it takes just a little bit less than that even, and there'll be breakfast available as well. All the men of the church are invited to be a part of that on this Saturday. Maybe Brother Flood, are you going to come talk to us about youth conference?
I want to thank our church membership for all of the work and preparation that they put into the youth conference so far leading up to it. And we're only 1 week away now. And so thank you so much for the scores and literally hundreds of people who have volunteered their time so far and committed to come during the conference. After the service tonight in the lobby will be Mrs. Gobby with the food services and taking up signups if you're available to help prepare some of the lunches or prepare serving and actually serve during one of the meal times at the conference. Please see her out in the lobby. And then Brother Padilla will be there with the maintenance signup board. And there's literally hundreds and hundreds of hours that need to be put into the conference in the maintenance, trying to turn our buildings around. And really, we've done such a good job. He really has about 20 more spots an hour long that are really needful during the conference time. So if you're available during that, and so it really has a lot of different times available, so please see him out in the lobby right after the evening service. And then obviously thank you to the church membership for praying for the conference and donating money and making sure that we're financially able to put this on. And this again is our 40th year of the conference. We're looking forward to having such a great time together, and we're looking forward to God moving in a great way.
Thank you, and I want to welcome you to church tonight. Good crowd, the Nolans. We're glad to have you here visiting from Washington, and Millers. I want to get back there and just see your face to face there. That's so great. I told my wife about you this morning. You've come through all these different health situations, and I'm proud of you so much. You drive a long ways in, and then your kids are with you as well. And all of you that are here tonight, Jackie Van Dyke works in one of our public schools here. Or one of our students is right with her that received a tremendous award at graduation last week. And he has his mother and dad in the deaf section here tonight. And we are so, so delighted. Mother was in church this morning, interpreted the service, and then dad's here tonight. And we're proud of the award. We're proud of mom and dad being in church tonight. Others are here visiting. We're grateful for all of you. The Crossroads will be having an activity tonight, right after the service at the Fanera's home, so you might want to be aware of that. I do want you to know that just in a few weeks, you'll receive a letter from me in the mail, and it's regarding Anniversary Sunday, July the 16th. We're 48 years of age, and an offering envelope in it, or you can give online. And at that time forward, we can give to this new building project. We hope to break ground next anniversary. The drawing is breathtaking, the site elevation, and you'll see it on Anniversary Sunday. I want to also mention to you my huge burden these days about Saturday night men's prayer. We have men's prayer at the other property with the Spanish ministry, and they're having a good crowd at their Spanish ministry, and men's prayer is in the auditorium right below me here, and we have a tremendous crowd, just an amazing crowd. It was built during COVID every Saturday night in those tents, and then when we came in, it continued to grow. We're in an urgent moment in America, and we've been praying since before Memorial Day through July 4th that God would do something special in this country. The only hope we have is God. The only hope. I mean, people can't think this stuff up. It's evil. It's sent from evil powers. You just could never think of the craziness that's going on. But I believe, like the choir sings from time to time, he's still on the throne. God is on the throne. And I hope that you'll come, man, at prayer. Then we're praying for youth conference next Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. I want you to know that there is a great army of young people in this country that still want to do right, still want to serve God. And I want you to pray for it. They're coming from not just the Western United States, all over the United States. And then tonight I want to say thank you for our listeners. I was sitting here, we were singing, thinking every continent is listening right now, and every state, and we're so very grateful for you. Page 61, I've been singing this today. I've never lost the wonder of it all since the day that Jesus saved me and a whole new life he gave me. Well, I've never lost the wonder of it all. We're on the course. Sing it together on the course. I have never lost the wonder of it all. I have never lost the wonder of it all since the day that Jesus saved me. Does this explain our life? Stanza one. What so aimlessly I wander round the tangled paths of sin? All about me seems so hopeless, doubts and fears without within. Then a voice so kind and gentle spoke, peace unto my soul. Gone my days of and wandering since the Savior. Sing it out all the last time through. I have never lost the wonder of it all. Page 59, could you go back there? We'll get ready for the offering, the preaching tonight. No, that's not it, brother. I'm sorry. Yes, that you turned the right page, 49. 40. You did it right. I should have sung that. For the beauty of the earth. I like that. I've been singing this tonight. The busy streets and sidewalks, they suddenly grew still as the man came through the entrance of the city. It was Jesus. Sing it together. The busy streets and sidewalks, they suddenly influenced by Dr. Harold Seitler in Greenville, Tennessee. He preached in a little country church, her daddy did, and then another church and another. He had one time five at the same time. And he listened to Dr. Harold Seitler preach. Love the Lord. And then daddy said, in order to make ends meet, I need to sell some insurance on the side. And began to make money, bought a fancy car, dropped one of the church, and dropped two, and dropped three, and dropped four, and the last one. He was young, he had a massive heart attack. And he said to his daughter that wrote this song, I played the fool. And he died shortly thereafter. She wrote so many good songs in our songbook. She wrote this one, Jesus, He is the Son of God. I thought of that song we sang about the wonder of it all. I believe it was Stuart Hamlin, if I remember, he wrote that. I talked to his wife on the phone one night during pastor's conference, right before we had the service. And she told me about Stuart. Of course, the testimony is John Wayne's neighbor. And John Wayne would never get saved, but Stuart Hamlin out of Hollywood got saved and wrote that song. And then I thought of that first song. Al Smith was at our church. He wrote For God So Loved the World, the chorus. He wrote that song, the wonder that, I never lost the wonder of it all. He told us all those hymns. We're a blessed church to have all these people through the years. I wonder if you could sing that last stanza. Then the air grew cold. Jesus, He is the Son of God. Sing that last stanza. Please. Then the air grew cold and the sky turned black as the sun turned to water. Every time for every man and every country. Thank you. one of these nights, Brother Martinez, you and Brother Galvan and all of us, we're going to just have a sing fest here. And just sing. That's wonderful. Well, June 30th is around the corner. And our finances are set up on a fiscal year that June 30th, the end of the year, we need to have more money in the bank than we have bills. The bills are enormous. It's unbelievable. And everything goes up. Our gasoline for our diesel buses is so high right now. And the insurance and the utilities and the food services. It just goes, it's skyrocketing. We're watching every dime we can watch. We need about $200,000 a week. It's a lot of money. And you imagine writing that much bills, a little less than that, not much. And though God's blessed us with debt retirement, these buildings are aging. The one at Clyde Avenue, one is 30 years old, one's 40 years old, and all these buildings are 20 years old, and this is in August, 17 years old. And when an air conditioner goes out, it's not just $5,000 or $10,000, it's enormous. And we have a lot of things we're fixing, and they need to be fixed. These elevators, they just are constant. It's a lot of money. And you've been good, but let's help on debt retire, help on the end of the year in the black by June 30th. Father, I thank you so much for the people of God, how good they've been. Soul winning's been so amazing this week. So many people out, so many out passing Bibles. I think of that new crowd of all those Filipino ladies I saw on Friday morning going out, and teenagers on Saturday morning going out, and all the soul winners. You've been so good to us. I thank you for the giving of your people. They've sacrificed and all they've done, especially over these last 12 to 13 years for debt retirement. We praise you for your goodness. And I pray that we do our very best to reach the budget and go beyond tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Moment, we'll dismiss the children as we sing 505, please. Page 505, It's My Desire. Kids, you get ready as we sing the first verse together of page number 505, It's My Desire. Lift it up on the first. It's My Desire. to live for Him. It's my desire to help someone to pay, someone who may to see the way. I too was once lost, but I found my way back to God. It's my desire to live for Him.
It's dark as a dungeon, and the sun seldom shines. And I question, Lord, why must this be? But He tells me there's strength in my sorrow, and there's victory in trials for me. He leads me beside still waters. Somewhere in the valley below, He draws me aside
Bible, turn with me to Genesis 22 tonight, please. The Old Testament, first book in your Bible. Genesis chapter 22, and what a good song that is. In fact, this is a story of God testing, God trying the faith of one of His choice children. We're going to see that tonight, and I pray God will speak to our hearts. You've probably seen it as much as I've seen it, and we're all aware of it, and I think we're aware of it all throughout the year. But you understand, and I do too, that there's a heightened reminder of how wicked our society is this month out of the year. It's very evident, and it's very obvious, and it's very blatant. We talked about it a little bit last night at men's prayer, just the different things that I saw just yesterday, just walking from the office to men's prayer as I looked at the news and different things, baseball teams and stadiums decked out for this, Yosemite National Park, a special event for this, where men would put on female park ranger outfits and walk young people through the park. And it's just really blatant, and Target and different, even Bud Light alcoholic beverage company taking backlash for promoting this, but it's everywhere in our culture and in our society. I want you to hear what I'm about to say, because I really believe it's true. Our nation is going to look, I didn't say it's might, it might, it is going to look drastically different in 5 years. And if not 5 years, then I'll give it a little bit of time, definitely in 10 years. And here's why I say that. I say that because the majority of voters in America are going to be that age bracket that are now 18 to 45 years old. And they're going to be the bulk of those who decide our elections. And that is going to change the face. If you think it has been bad, wait until the generation that has grown up believing that everything we've preached against is okay and normal and right goes to the voting booth. We've already lost holidays. Christmas is not Christian. And Easter is not Christian in America anymore. We've already lost our schools. That's not going to come back. What Pastor mentioned this morning, how he grew up with that, and we grew up with that to an extent where I'm from, and the Pledge of Allegiance, that is not going to come back in our public school system. That is not happening. And if you notice the attack of evil, it is not really aimed at the elderly. And it is not primarily aimed at what we would say middle-aged. It is aimed at our children. And it is aimed at the next generation to come. For a little while this evening, I want to preach and speak on behalf of the next generation. I want you to see this story in Genesis chapter 22. I read a quote, and it's a striking quote. Adolf Hitler made the statement. He said, "He who gains the youth controls the future." And I think that's what's going on today, as we see parental rights taken away and church authority questioned and government sovereignty put in place over our young people. I want you to see what it says in Genesis 22. The Bible says, "And it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham." And that word tempt is the word try or test. He's proving Abraham. "And said unto him," Abraham, "and he said, Behold, here am I. And he said, Take now thy son, thine only son, Isaac, whom thou lovest." Now let me stop and say this. You have never been tested until you've been tested in the area of what you love. He said, "I want you to take this boy, Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I will tell thee of." And Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass and took two of his young men with him and Isaac his son, and clave the wood for the burnt offering and rose up and went into the place of which God had told him. Then on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off. And Abraham said unto his young men, "Abide ye here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship, and come again to you." And Abraham took the wood and the burnt offering and laid it upon Isaac his son, and he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and they went both of them together. That's an important word, together. And Isaac spake unto Abraham his father and said, "My father." And he said, "Here am I, my son." And he said, "Behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering?" And Abraham said, "My son, God will provide." That's a good statement to underline right there. Just those three words, "God will provide." That's good for us every day.
But it's also a prophetic statement that God fulfilled when you read the rest. God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. So they went, both of them, and here's the word again, together. And they came to the place which God had told him of. And Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order and bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar upon the wood. And Abraham stretched forth his hand and took the knife to slay his son. And the angel of the Lord called unto him out of heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, Here am I. And he said, Lay not thine hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him, for now I know that thou fearest God, seeing thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, from me. And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked. Behold, behind him a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered him for a burnt offering in the stead of his son. It's amazing. There's been lambs mentioned three times up to this point. A lamb in Genesis to cover Adam's sin. A lamb in Exodus, the blood applied, or rather we'll see the blood applied in here, this lamb that's a substitute. Jesus Christ fulfilled all of it, of course. Verse 14, and Abraham called the name of that place, look at this, Jehovah Jireh. As it is said to this day, in the mount of the Lord, and I want you to see the phrase, it shall be seen. Now we read this and think that this was for Abraham, and it was. But Abraham wasn't on the mountain alone. I don't think God did this just to test or prove Abraham's faith. Abraham had heard God, he had seen God, he had walked with God, he had experienced God, he knew God, he was a friend of God. But Abraham had a son named Isaac. And there is nothing recorded in the scripture from the birth of Isaac to this account where Isaac heard from God, knew God, saw God, walked with God. I'm not saying that he didn't, I'm just saying it's not in the Bible. I think God did this not just for Abraham, I think he did this for Isaac too. I think God wanted Isaac to see Abraham be faithful to God. I think God wanted Isaac to watch his father obey God. I think he wanted to see Abraham trust God, and then God wanted the opportunity to show Isaac he always comes through. For a little while this evening, I want to preach on this thought so that the next generation might see God. So that the next generation might see God. Let's pray. God, please help me tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Psalm 78, verse 5 through 7 says this, For he established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which he commanded our fathers that they should make them known to their children, that the generation to come might know them, even the children which should be born, who should arise and declare them to their children, that they might set their hope in God and not forget the works of God, but keep his commandments. I did a lot of research when I prepared this message, so I'm going to give you some numbers, but I want you to hear it. A Barna poll said only 4% of Americans today hold a biblical worldview. Only 4%. That means 96% of the people that you and I live with in our country do not use the Bible as the basis for how they see the world. But even more striking than that, only 1% of people age 18 to 29 have a biblical worldview. And at the same time, 20% of that age bracket would identify as gay, lesbian, transgender, or something of that nature. That Barna poll said this, that age bracket is aggressively rejecting biblical principle. I want to come to tonight by way of this message on behalf of the generation that is to come. I want to come to you on behalf of the young people that sit in our Sunday school classes. I want to come to you tonight on behalf of the babies that are in the nursery right now. I want to come to you on behalf of the students that are sitting in the classrooms of our Christian school and the young servants that we train in our Bible college. I want to come to you tonight on behalf of the bus kids who cannot preach for themselves and the public school kids, the youth conference delegates that will fill this place in a week. How about the children that live on your street and in our city and the babies that are yet to be born? The Christian population was 90% in 1970 in America. They say by the year 2040, it'll be 40% and dropping rapidly. The responsibility of you and I to make God known and the task to lead the next generation to set their hope in God falls heavily tonight upon our shoulders. I don't know if you realize this or not, and I'm going to talk to you who are closer to my age, but we are getting older. We are not children anymore. I don't know if it's just me, but sometimes in my mind, I still think of myself as I should be sitting with that group right there. But it's very obvious and it's very evident that we're getting older. For example, I know what an ice tray is. Do you know that? I know what a newspaper is. I've even dialed with like this on a phone before and watched the wheel come back around. Some people say I have gray hair, but they have bad eyesight. But it's a lie is what it is. But somehow I wonder, you and I who are closer to my age, if we still think we are the next generation. We are not the next generation. We are this generation. And the responsibility is not coming to us to lead a younger generation into the things of God. The responsibility is already heavily upon us to rise up and lead the next generation to set their hope in God. In an ever-increasing, Christ-rejecting culture, and in a society that is greatly unchurched, the weight of our duty is more pressing than it's ever been before. It was nothing for our grandparents and our parents to go to church every single week. But now it is nothing for our generation to never darken the door of a church in their entire life. As you go out soul winning, you'll notice it is frequently more and more the case when I talk to somebody, it is not that they have casually attended church, it is that they have never heard the gospel and they have never attended a service at a church. The statistics tell the story. Even a growing number of people, parents who claim to be Christian, openly admit to never taking their family to church. That means there's an entire generation in our country that is being reared without the necessity and importance of God being planted in their hearts. They might say they know God, they might even use the title Christian, but they know nothing of what it is to be faithful to serving God or walking with Him every single day. Consider it with me. They don't know what it is to attend Sunday school. They don't know what it is to sing along with the congregation. They don't know what it is to give in an offering plate. They don't know what it is to hear a preacher preach. The idea of church is an alien idea to the majority of children in our country and even to their parents who would claim to be a Christian. They've never attended vacation Bible school. They've never gone to a youth camp. They've never sat in a youth conference. They don't attend a patch class. They don't go to a Bible club. They don't have a chapel in their school. They never attend a youth hour. And there is a generation behind us that desperately needs introduced to the gospel and introduced to the Lord Jesus Christ. The world and the culture around us that we are ministering to today is not the world and the culture that our parents and grandparents ministered to. I want to address my generation on behalf of that generation. I want to talk to the moms and dads tonight if I can. I want to talk to the Sunday school teachers. I want to talk to the leaders, the grandparents. We have youth conference coming up, and I said this last night. Sometimes I fear we think, well, youth conference is for God to get a hold of those young people so they can turn this world around, and we want the young people to carry the water for us. Their spiritual responsibility should not fall upon that generation. Not yet. The spiritual responsibility falls on our generation. Tonight, you and I are blessed to know God. We are blessed to be born again. We are blessed to enjoy fellowship in a church like ours. We are blessed tonight, but we are blessed because a generation before us led us to the place where we could see God for ourselves. They labored for us so we could see God. They loved on us so we could see God. They invested in us so we could see God. They fought for us so we could see God. They corrected us so that we could see God. They trained us so that we could see God. They sacrificed to build and gave and provided these things for us. They walked with God so that we would see God. They taught us to pray so we could see God. They opened to us the scripture so we could see God. They gave us what we needed so our hope would not be set somewhere else, but we could anchor our hope in God. We're not here tonight by accident. We are not here by good luck. We are here by the grace of God and the guidance of a faithful generation that led before us. I read a statement that said it only takes one generation to change a culture. Population researchers report this, that babies born between 1981 and the early 2000s, 2015 earlier, will probably be the largest generation ever born in America. The babies that are born in that age bracket have the very negative connotation. We know what they are. They are millennials and Gen Z. That is 45 years old or so, down to the late teens, early 20s. Those are the young married couples and the middle-aged parents of America. They are the leaders of the homes in our country. They're the leaders of most of the businesses. They are becoming the leaders in politics. But concerningly, they are not the leaders in America's churches. The strength for the future of our church lies in that generation. That generation, largely, needs to learn how to teach and train and sing and give, amen, and serve and do right. Now, let me give you a little bit of description. In describing millennials, they say they differ from the older generation in several ways. They're more tech savvy. They're more community-minded. They're more socially engaged. They see themselves as citizens of the world and are more likely to start and run their own business. They don't want to work for anybody else. They're not as comfortable with a rigid schedule. They're more flexible. They have some church background, but they're more casual with their affiliation. They are far more secularized in their spirituality than were their parents. That would be the older age bracket. But here's the Gen Z. Listen to this. Gen Z, this is a concerning generation. It's called the first post-Christian generation. They are twice as likely to be atheist than that of millennials. Gen Z is driven to make money. They are likely to take multiple vacations throughout the year. They are ambitious and yet suffer with anxiety. They are avid gamers even in adulthood. They are social, but only through social networking. This generation is invested in perception and worried about acceptance more so than reality. They are more inclined to learn from peers than from predecessors. This crowd has very little or no church background. They are a spiritual blank slate and pride themselves on being open to any ideology and scorn narrow-mindedness. They are all about authenticity and not much about absolute authority. And the reason I bring that up is that is what we have, the building material for the future of the church if Christ does not come back. That is what we're dealing with. That is the character. That is the personality. That is the drive of the age group that we need, listen, to start manning bus routes and teaching classes and singing in the choir and filling our pews. Everybody all right? When former generations would live and die in one town, in one house, at one job, and probably one church, the current generation is in constant evolution and flux. The pursuit of finding myself is stronger than the ideal of being faithful. My grandfather lived and died, same company. And he loved that company. Loyal to it, bragged on it. I mean, he was dyed in the wool. That's not today. Today, we're not loyal to a company, we're not loyal to a city, not loyal much to a church. It is very normal to switch fields, and it's done frequently, and we do not put roots down very deep. Now, the reason I'm preaching this tonight is I want to get to the fact that this is going to impact our children. Yeah. It can be evidence. Now, watch this. Population researchers say this. There's a tendency among this generation to be more self-absorbed and less family-oriented than the previous generation. I could prove that to you by watching Nick at Night. Yeah. Go back and watch the old TV shows and then watch the modern ones. The old television shows that we wouldn't even recommend necessarily, but they center upon the home and the family and real life. Today, television shows are all fantasy or career or about the individual. Now you can see this. I traveled the country for over a decade, preached in a lot of independent Baptist churches, and I can testify and tell you I was the youngest person in almost every Baptist church that I preached in. I hardly ever preached for a pastor my age. I never sat in a pew with people my age. I never listened to special music sung by people my age. So there is a definite gap and hole in our American churches with people in my age bracket. I can prove this. It is evidence if you travel by the aging population of most of the workers in our churches. And I thank God for those workers, but it also concerns me. Across America, the norm is that the more aged members of a church run and fund the program, while the younger families are casual and avoid commitment. They say in America we're losing the middle class, but I'm afraid in Christianity we're losing the middle-aged. Something to note is the older people who are still frantically serving in churches that are bailing water to keep that ship from sinking are the children of a generation before them that fulfilled their task to train their children to set their hope in God. They broke up the soil, planted a seed, let the tree grow, and then their children sat under the shade of that tree. Secular polling says parents from our generation, my generation, largely raised their children in front of a screen, while the former generation used the table. Instead of hands-on, our generation uses technology to be hands-off. The use of technology has and is creating an ever-shrinking attention span that stands in direct opposition to the model found in Nehemiah, where they read in the book of the law of God distinctly, gave the sense, and caused them to understand the reading. We have been conditioned to watch a two-hour movie and think that went fast, and then get mad if a sermon runs over 20 minutes. We cannot meditate because we're so conducive to scrolling. Every post has to be short. Every soundbite has to be snappy. Every video has to be quick. And this conditioning makes my generation's ability to stay engaged in church almost impossible. Listen to the number. From 30 to 44 years old, only 25% of Americans attend church. That's why we see this performance revolution in our churches. It's a hybrid church model that tries to use media to make make spiritual things more stimulating. Because we spend our life with something electric going before our eyes all day long, and now it's not enough just to open up the Word of God in the power of the Holy Spirit. We have to have something of external stimuli to keep us engaged. This generation gets its philosophy, its news, its counsel, and even its spiritual leadership from social media, whether it's qualified, factual, or not. It's true that something you read online often holds more weight than a Bible verse. And truth is more and more unpalatable to the contemporary palate. Our generation has free access to endless information, but what that does is it produces a fluid loyalty to a plurality of principles and values. And now final authority is called bigoted, and truth is situational. They say one reason why Gen Z does not attend churches, it is too exclusive, and it does not accept some of these things, these lifestyles that the Bible blatantly says are an abomination and sin against God. And the reason is, listen, they've been conditioned to think, well, everything is fluid, and everything is situational ethics. And so we're losing that crowd to this mindset. This generation is rather being true to itself than truthful. The previous generation, Christ would be a stumbling block. But to my generation, Christ has become foolishness. The love of country is xenophobic to our generation. Every nation and culture is as good as the next. Traditions and norms are negotiable. The pattern passed down and the values from our parents no longer go unchallenged. And it's rare to find a Lois to Eunice to Timothy sort of a pattern today. I thought about the previous generation. I'm heavy on introduction, but listen to me. The previous generation lived through the church growth movement. We are living through the church closing movement. The older generation did not live in an America where they drove by vacant church buildings and drove through Sunday morning through a town without hearing a bell ring somewhere in a steeple. But our generation, and our children especially, are driving through cities and riding through towns where churches have for sale signs in the yard. There's no sound of a church bell ringing, and some cities don't even have a gospel representation in their city. This is the most disconnected, connected generation there has ever been. People are disconnected from in-person work. Over 25% of the full-time workforce now is working remotely. We are disconnected from our extended family. We used to have family reunion every year. I'm talking about we showed up and you could see them and touch them and, you know, aunt whatever, pinch your cheeks till they bled. I mean, in person. We don't do that anymore. You know why? We don't need to. We see each other every day on Facebook. But now we're missing it. We're disconnected. We're disconnected from in-person shopping. We don't even have to go to the grocery store. They'll bring it right to our front door. We're disconnected from church. But the dangerous and obvious result of this is, if we're that disconnected, how disconnected are our children gonna be? Our children aren't gonna even have the opportunity to ask what meaneth these stones, because they're never gonna see the stones to begin with. This trend is 100% against the Bible command and example. We've only made it to this point because the previous generation did not disconnect themselves, but they connected themselves to the next generation. God has made it known from generation to generation by word and deed. I imagine as weary fathers and faithful mothers made church a priority and the Bible the standard, and it wasn't that life was any easier for them, and it wasn't that they were less busy. It's just that God was more of a priority. Priority, and they got themselves to the house of God. Churches were filled with families, and buses were run by families, and choirs were filled by families, and altars were lined with families. Not today. I'm here on behalf of the next generation. I'm speaking to my generation, but I want to speak on behalf of the younger generation. It falls on you and I tonight to make sure the next generation has a chance at least to set their hope in God. There's a movement of deconstruction where folks my age are deconstructing their faith, but my fear is the younger generation won't even be able to construct a faith if we're not getting them around the things of God. They need to see us love God. They need to hear you say amen. They need to watch you get on an altar. They need to see you study your Bible. They need to shadow you as you go soul winning. They need put in an atmosphere with spiritual depth. They're facing things and will face things that you and I never had to face. The furnace has been heated 7 times hotter for their generation, and they're living in a country that is post-Christian and openly perverted. America is not leaning left, it has leapt left. And it's not just in San Francisco, it is in every corner of America. When our young people salute the flag, they're in the minority. If they live a moral life, they will be the exception. If they try to live for God, they are going to be an oddity. And tonight, my fear is the church is lagging woefully behind in evangelizing. We are losing to the LGBTQ+2 whatever movement. They are far more faithful in evangelizing our children than we are. We are losing to socialists because they are far more active at evangelizing your children in this public school system than we are. We are losing to atheists because they are far more active than we are. We are losing to academic institutions because they are far more active and rabid about what they believe than we are. Contemporary culture is winning the race to convert our children. The world is excellent at apologetics, and the average Christian knows nothing of how to express their faith to another generation. The legal system's against us. The educational system's against us. The social construct is against us. The mainstream narrative is against us. The arts narrative is against us. The entertainment narrative is against us. The rising athletic stars and political figures are against us. And they put so much money and so much time and so much effort into reaching your children and to winning your kids to their position. They will not enable them to set their hope in God. They will set their hope in something else. They're going to think God is some bigoted misogynist in the sky. They're going to have some faith in government or faith in humanism, and they're going to be miserable and fall and fail if they don't set their hope in God. We say there's going to be a shift in America. Neighbor, it has already shifted. America has already shifted morally, spiritually, and socially. We think wokeness is weird, but they know Christianity is weird. We talk about wokeness like it's a few people. Don't you understand that we don't live in a Christian nation? We live in a pagan nation that has a Christian foundation, and we're doing all we can to salvage what's left. But wokeness is not the fringe. Wokeness is the day. Don't you understand that? Whenever you and I, we gotta have more than just saying, well, bless God, this. You better know what you believe and why you believe it. When you go to Target and you see all the perverted things there and the clothing sections, and you go to that ball game and you feel like, well, there's just a few weirdos. No, you're the weirdo. Everybody all right? The average American today sees no need for church because they don't know church. We're not dealing with folks who've jumped around every church in town. We're dealing with folks who've never even been to church. They see no reason to go to church for any kind of moral advancement, no spiritual advancement. There's no hope for the next generation if we do not reach down to them. Think about it. If all the next generation knows about Christianity is that we lean right in our politics, we have failed. If all they know is, well, we're against gay marriage and we're against abortion and we're for this or that or the other, and they do not know Christ, we have failed. I'm concerned for the next generation. In a decade, I believe we'll have thousands of vacant church buildings if we don't get serious. We'll have hundreds of rusted out buses if parents don't get serious. Empty Christian schools if parents don't get serious. Christian colleges will have to close if parents don't get serious. Mission fields will have no witness if this generation, my generation, does not get serious. Cities will be without a pastor. Lost people will be without a soul winner. There'll be no hope because they will not know God. If we fail to pass light to the next generation, how dark will be their day? We can't afford to get disconnected here. The screen is not going to fix this for us. The social media guru is not going to fix this for us. The only answer is the next generation must be able to see God. I want my son to see God more than any other sight in this world. I'm not against going sightseeing, and we do sightseeing, but can I say the most important thing for somebody to see in this life is to get a good glimpse of God by the eye of faith. I want him to see God through faith. I want him to see God tangibly and what God can do. I want him to see the fruit of faith in God. I want him to be a part of something where he doesn't have to just hear me talk about it in past tense tone, but I want him to experience God firsthand. Can I say, if that's going to happen, it's going to take more than you and I showing up and going through the motions and the routine of church Sunday and Wednesday and being dead and just amen and oh me and yawn through the service. No, we're going to have to get a hold of the horns of the altar and cry out to God and make God real to that generation. They're going to have to see you in your prayer closet and see you giving to God and see you sacrificing and see you living right and doing right and loving the Lord. It takes more than just telling them. They're going to have to see it. They need more than spiritual ideals and moral expectations. They need to know Christ from Genesis to Revelation, from in the beginning God to Mount Calvary. They need to know God is real. Let me give you a few things to consider about this text and we'll close. Number one, you know the story, so we don't have to go through the whole passage. Abraham has been commanded by God to take his son and sacrifice him. But I want you to notice some things here. If you and I are going to impact the next generation, number one, you're going to have to be sensitive to God. Look at verse number one. And it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham and said unto him, Abraham, watch with this. And he said, behold, here am I. God spoke, and Abraham heard. If we're going to impact the next generation, we're going to have to be in tune to the voice of God. The choir sang the song that he still speaks, and we sing it and sing along with it, but you know, he really does. And it's a very important day for you and I that are parents and you and I that are leaders in this thing right now, that we're sensitive to God. We can't afford to get out of God's will is what I'm saying. We can't afford to miss it. We can't afford to be hasty in our decisions. We can't afford to just go because it looks easier or it looks more beneficial or whatever in the immediate. We've got to be sensitive to the leading of God. I'm glad that he had a father. When God spoke, he heard his voice. That's more important and that's more impressive than your book of contacts or who you've talked to this week on your phone or what kind of business deals you've made this year. Wouldn't it be something if your young person could say, well, Daddy knows God and Mama knows God and I know they talk to God and God talks to them. You've got to be sensitive to God. Number two, be surrendered to God. Look at verse 2. And he said, take now thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I'll tell thee of. And look what he says. And Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass and took of his young men with him and Isaac his son. He did exactly what God told him to do. He knew it was going to cost him, and it hurt, and it was hard, but he was willing to sacrifice. At the end of this text, Isaac gets to see God do something he'd never seen God do before. But it starts with Abraham being sensitive and then Abraham sacrificing. It's expensive to live here. We talk about it too much, maybe, but you know it is. But the expense of your housing is a lot cheaper than the expense of losing your family. The expense of the groceries is a lot less than the expense of wrecking your life. You say, well, I'm sacrificing. Yeah, you are sacrificing. You know what God does? He blesses sacrifice. And you know what? Every once in a while, it is a good thing for the younger generation to see that we have to pray bread in on the table. I think so. I think it's okay. Now we complain about it. I was going to be honest with you. I complain about it. I get nervous about it. It scares me half to death. But God always puts the bread on the table. Over and over, again and again, God's been faithful. And you say, but it's easier over there. I talked to somebody just here recently. They want to move somewhere they've never even been before. They've never visited. They don't know anybody there, but it's cheaper. That's a dumb thing to do. Sacrifice. He was sensitive to God. Number three, let me give you a third thing. Be steady for God. Look at verse 3. And Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass and took of his young men with him and Isaac his son and clave the wood for the burnt offering and rose up and went unto the place which God told him. Now watch what it says in verse 4. Then on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off. Now think about it. If God came to you and said, I want you to sacrifice your child, the son that you love, as a burnt offering, that's a hard decision to make. But it's even harder when you consider he had to deal with that for 3 days. They traveled for 3 days, Abraham knowing what he's going to do. But what I like about the text is it never says Abraham doubted or questioned or got bitter or got mad or angry and said, it's not fair, it's not right. God, why? He didn't do that. You know what he did? He just walked on by faith. Why? He did not want to make Isaac bitter and mad at God too. Oh my, how are you going to impact the next generation? By not complaining all the time about how God has done you wrong. I guarantee you this, God's not done you wrong. Anything outside of hell is more than you deserve, amen, and me as well. God's been too good to us to complain and pout. Oh, I'm getting mad about everything. Well, we don't get this, and we can't go there. And my generation, it's like perpetual adolescent. It's crazy to me. We're spoiled because our parents spoiled us, I think. Now, if somebody older than me preached this, I'd be ticked, but I'm going to preach it because I am one of us, okay? Think about it. It's true, though. Is it not true? We're never happy. We're never satisfied. We always want more. We always think it's better if we go there. We get what we wanted and then find out, well, I didn't really think it's not what I thought it was, and now I want this. That is immature. But not only that, whenever we voice our opinion about how God got it wrong, they're listening. Amen. And you want to make somebody bitter? And you want to make somebody who's going to be unfaithful and say, well, I don't want church. Why? I don't want to go to church. All those people are miserable who go. Why would I want to go and be miserable with the rest of those old people there at the church? Just complain. Be steady for God. What I mean is don't cast shade on God. Don't doubt God. Don't cast shade on your Bible, your church. Be a good soldier. Be steadfast. Just endure hardness. Amen. Lead. And number four, watch this. Be sensitive to God. Be surrendered to God. Be steady for God. Number four, be sharpening in God. And I'll explain it. Look at verse 6. Look what he says. And Abraham took the wood and burnt offering and laid it upon Isaac, his son. Now, it's interesting. He laid it upon Isaac. He's letting Isaac get involved in what they're doing. And Isaac's going to be more involved than he planned in a minute. But he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and they went both of them, and here's that word, together. And verse 8, and Abraham said, my son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. So they went both of them, and watch the word, together. And they came to the place which God had told him of, and Abraham built an altar there, and he laid the wood in order and bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar upon the wood. It's interesting. God had Abraham and Isaac do this thing together. They're in this thing together. It's not just Abraham going up on the mountain. It is Abraham and Isaac together going up on the mountain. If we're going to help this generation set their hope in God, here's what we're going to have to do. Be willing to sharpen them in the things of God. You see what you're talking about? I mean, we're going to have to be willing to teach them about God. We're going to be willing to disciple them, if you will, train them, explain to them the scripture, allow them to ask us questions and not be scared to answer them, and then find out if I don't know the answer, then maybe I ought to study and figure out why I believe what I believe. Here's what they want. They want you to be real. And here's what I found out. It doesn't matter how loud I scream it, how long I preach it, or how firm I declare it. If I cannot explain it and prove it, they're not going to hear it. But if I'll take the time to go down with them and rub elbows with them and talk with them and love on them, I tell you, it does a whole lot more. That 1 week at teen camp, or a few days at youth conference, or going to youth hour, or taking them out for, y'all ain't old enough to drink coffee, but coffee, if your parents don't find out, well, drink coffee, and do something like that. I mean, it means more than sitting through a five-hour sermon. Yeah. We're sitting here in the service, and the Foley boys have graduated over there, so I caught you, though, anyway, tonight. But every week while they're sitting down here, I'm having conversations with them with our eyes. Yeah. I don't know what they're saying to me. I know what I'm trying to say to them. But they'll look back at me. Tonight, we did that. And I just went like this, because I didn't know what you were trying to tell me. But anyway, I want to interact with these guys. Why? If I just get up there and scream at them for 45 minutes, that's one thing. But when I take the time to come down there and actually talk to them and spend time with them, pray with them, that goes a whole lot further. But listen, you say, I don't have a youth group. You have a young person in your house. You know, you could read the Bible with your family. Your son or your daughter, you could pray together before your meals. Amen. You know, if you have a child, you could take them soul winning with you. Bible distributing or whatever it is. Bus washing on Saturday with your young man, men's prayer. You can bring your son to men's prayer. You can go to faithfulness rally together. I mean, there's a whole lot of things. If your family sings, you can sing together. But I'm talking about those kind of things matter for the next generation. Number one, be sensitive. Number two, be surrendered. Number three, be steady. Number four, be sharpening. And then lastly, just be satisfied with what God does. Look at verse number 9. Let's read the end of verse number 10, rather, through the end of the text we read. And Abraham stretched forth his hand and took the knife to slay his son. And the angel of the Lord called unto him out of heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, Here am I. And he said, Lay not thine hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him. For now I know that thou fearest God, seeing thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, from me. And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered him up for a burnt offering in the stead of his son. But I like what he says. And Abraham called the name of that place Jehovah Jireh. As it is said to this day, in the mount of the Lord, it shall be seen. You see what God did? He provided a blessing, a miracle for Abraham. And I like what it says. Abraham took it and said, I like that. We're going to use that. And he gives it the testimony. It's going to be seen right here. Now, that has a few different meanings, but I like this primary meaning. Isaac got to see God provide for his father. Amen. And he got to see his father rejoice in the fact God provided. I'd say the conversation to the mountain, very somber, still, quiet. I'd say the conversation on the way back down the mountain was Isaac going, "Woo! Hey! Let me tell you what God did up on the mountain. I'd never seen it like that before. I'd heard Daddy talk about it. I'd heard him in his prayer closet. I'd watch him walk out there in the fields and on the plains, and he seemed to be happy in the Lord. But I tell you what I saw. I saw God do something for me. I saw God show up. I saw God step in. I saw God show off and show out. I saw God do what only God can do." He ran down and grabbed those two servants and said, "Hey, guess what? God's not just real for Daddy. God's been real for me." And then I can see him running home and getting his mother and saying, "Mama, guess what? The God that's been good to Daddy, and the God that's been good to you, and the God that gave you a miracle just gave me a miracle of my own." And you read the Bible and find that Isaac walked with God like his daddy walked with God, but it's because his father obeyed and was faithful and obedient, just followed God and allowed him to see God work. I wish I would have documented 15 years of traveling to, quote unquote, the best churches in America, which are pretty in need. And I wish you could look around those churches that have a great perception but see the reality. And look around and see that in 5 years, 10 years, that church is not going to exist. Yes, sir. Because everybody who has to keep the thing running only has about 5 to 10 years to live if the Lord doesn't come back. And my age bracket is missing. They will attend, and they might give, probably not going to tithe, but they will give sometimes. But can I tell you something? You and I might make it through, but our children are going to be in a mess. And I want to come to you on behalf of them. It's time for you and I to step up, be faithful, so that they might see God for their generation. Let's bow our heads just for a moment. I pray God will speak to your heart about that. Those statistics are kind of dry to use, but they're pretty staggering to think about. We are dealing with a country now that doesn't even know church, know God, and they are actively reaching in to our churches and our young people and evangelizing them, if that's the word we want to use. We have got to do something. We have got to step up. We've got to meet that need. It starts at home. You've heard that said, a church is only as strong as the homes that make it up. Parents need to lead their children in the things of God. It starts with Sunday school teachers and Christian school teachers and those who have influence. If we were as active and put as much money and effort and time into reaching that generation as the world does. We put a lot of money and time in it here with youth conference and camps, but Lord, help us. I pray tonight that you'd speak to our hearts about this truth. I pray that you'd help us to serve our generation by the will of God and also make it known to the next generation that you're good and that you're real and that you're in control. And I pray that they might set their hope in you. I pray that you'd salvage our country. I pray that if revival doesn't happen anywhere else, you'd allow it to take place here. God, I pray for our leaders, God. I pray that they'd either be saved or silenced. I pray that you'd do something to let the world know you're still God. And I pray your people would serve you in Jesus' name. Amen. The altar is open. I pray if you, God spoke to your heart, if you want to come pray tonight, maybe you'd step out and come. You could come pray with your children or family if you want to. Come pray by yourself. But if God spoke to your heart, if you want to come pray tonight, this altar is open. That's why these youth conferences are so important. And the youth hour and the camp that we'll have in August are very important things. But every day is so important with our young people. Every day. Every day. The numbers are so staggering with that age group, 18 to 29, that don't have a biblical worldview. But why would they? That's the first generation really to grow up with this legislation that we have now that promotes all of these things that are so blatantly anti-God. That is their norm every day in school, on the news and television. They see it. Even yesterday, just scrolling quickly through a channel that's supposed to have children programming on it, I saw it there. It's everywhere. Lord, I pray that you please put a hedge about this place. Help us to continue to shine forth a light. And God, I pray that we do our part to make sure the next generation has a chance. And I pray that you'd help us to fight and stand in Jesus' name. Amen.
With our heads bowed, just spend the time you need to there. Tell God why you came. My goodness, Brother Cooper would agree with me, the best parents in all the world right here. But we're losing this thing right before our very eyes. Father, I pray that when we pass away or when the rapture comes, we'd be faithful to the house of God. Jesus gave his life for the church. And I pray that we not be casual. And as our hearts ache sometimes, as perhaps some of these dear folks, their children have wandered away from the things of Christ, may we as elderly people just keep going to your house. May we die loving thee and serving thee. Stir us up, wake us up is my prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. As he plays that, do you really want revival? We won't sing it, but I was singing that before church tonight. Do we really want revival? I don't believe in re-preaching a man's message. I normally don't say it, but just a moment or two. This has been a great church. It still is for so many years. But you know, some, I've pastored you for 10 and 20 and 30 years. You've never passed the Bible. You've never gone soul winning. You've never been to a men's prayer meeting. And this is the Sunday night crowd. And you love me, and you love my wife, and you love our church, and you're faithful. We're seeing our country explode with corruption. Youth conference is coming next week, and let me just tell you, this place will be packed. We'll have the same crowd as usual, but now wait a minute. I could tell you of 5 churches that used to run over 100. Not one of those churches will be here. They've come up, 100 kids, 5 of them, to youth conference. Not one will be here. The largest church outside of North Valley will have over 100, but the largest church is 36 people. They used to come in buses. Now if they come in a van, it's a miracle. They're gone. Ask our kids that are out traveling this summer. They'll go to churches that were one time had a big youth group, and there's nothing left. How the nursery is on a Sunday night is what your generation's going to look like. I had a couple tell me 3 weeks ago in their 20s, they said, now we'll be gone for the next year. We're just going to go all over America, work my job remote and go all over America. I've had so many say, we won't be here all summer. Young couples, young kids. We're just traveling all summer. We can work our jobs. We're gone all summer. I don't understand that. We've got a world that's going to hell, and your kids are going to inherit it. They've been inheriting. Sweet couple, I love them dearly. Said, Pastor, this morning at the door, we've been here 30 years. We own some other houses in other cities and other countries. We're going to move. I said, where are you going to church? Well, do you know of one? That happens almost every time now. We bought a house in such and such a city. Do you know of a church you can remember? During COVID, it happened every few weeks. One family came to me and said, we're leaving. I said, well, when do you leave? They said, tomorrow. They said, we don't know of any church in our area. I'm not trying to be cruel or mean or certainly not re-preach the message. That was so powerful. We've talked about the message. It just burdens me. Thank you for the Christian school. Thank you for supporting it. Thank you for loving it. Thank you for the college. Many of our parents in our churches in America don't want their kids in a Bible college. They want them in a Christian college so they can learn to be professionals. What about, as David said, he served his own generation after God. But in a moment, we're going to dismiss the music people, and they're going to go downstairs. There's an elevator if you need it. Pianist and special singing people. It'll take us about 12 minutes. And our class is going to go over to the courtyard in the first floor, and Brother Reimers will be with me, and he's going to start the meeting downstairs in just a moment. I'll show up. But we have our class all lined up, and the people are going to begin it over there. That'd be great. Let's do this, please. Let's stand. And Brother Cooper, I hope I didn't come and throw cold water. But you, those stats, you can go on and on. We've talked about it. I'm telling you, folks, the average church size in America is 46 people. The average church averages 46. This nation needs God's house. And I'm not interested in going out on a shuffleboard court. Have no desire. I have a desire to give more to you people and more to God than I ever have. My wife's the same. We've hit a little bump right now with her health. I don't want a life of ease. I'd be dead in 6 months. I can't do that. My theme this year is so much the more, Jack. I want to do more for God. And, well, enough of that. Let's do this. Riley and Hudson, will you help your Nana if you'll get her down in the elevator? Let's just dismiss right now the music people, please. All those people that sang, and I'm never a singer. I'm so ticked off at them. Please go quickly. It'll take us 12 minutes downstairs. We're ready to go. Brother Reamer's going to start. All of you back out the back doors, the side doors, wherever you want to go. That's it. If you're in a music group or you play the piano for one of the specials, thank you for going. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Wow. And we thank God for those people. They do such a good job. And I thank God for you. I love you folks so much. And you pray that I give more of my life to you. I want to do more for you. You let me know if you have a prayer request. I want to pray with you. And we're not quitting on this thing. We have Superintendent Bill Manley, who retired several years ago and been teaching Sunday school for superintendent for 43 years. And Brother Skirty back there for 45 years probably. Gray hair, no hair. Jim Carrey, 45 years teaching junior church here. I mean, our fellows are getting, and we're getting young people to help us. But I'm telling you something, we need to keep all you young people serving God. Thank you so much for that message. I love you folks so much. I'd sing my last song with you. I wanted to sing, but we're out of time. God bless you. You are dismissed.